Hello friends, welcome to Abhinav Goswami Law Classes. So friends, in this video we are going to discuss section 24 of Indian Evidence Act. So friends, we have so far already covered provisions regarding admissions. So from today onwards, we will be starting with confessions from section 24 up to section 30. So friends, if you have your BEREC with you, please open it up, open section 24. So I'm going to read from there. Confession caused by inducement, threat or promise when irrelevant in criminal proceedings. Okay, a confession made by an accused person is irrelevant in a criminal proceeding if the making of the confession appears to the court to have been caused by any inducement, threat or promise having reference to the charge against the accused person proceeding from a person in authority and sufficient in the opinion of the court to give to the accused person grounds which would appear to him reasonable for supposing that by making it he would gain any advantage or avoid any evil of a temporal nature in reference to the proceedings against him. So friends, quite broad, a very big section. There will be a lot of requirements, but yet it is very simple. Don't get confused. Don't think that it is very hard. It is one of the simplest section of the part regarding confessions. Okay, so let's start with it. So we will divide the sections as we always do, that we will divide the section into parts. So the first requirement for the application of section 24 is that the nature of the proceedings should be criminal. Okay, so not applicable, section 24 is not applicable in civil proceedings. Okay, criminal proceeding, first requirement. What is the second requirement? So who is going to decide whether the confession is caused by inducement, threat or promise? So it is the court. So in the second requirement, the role of the court comes to fore. So court must be appearing to the court that the confession is caused by any inducement, threat or promise. So this appearing to the court is very necessary. What other party is thinking, what you yourself as a party is thinking, what normal people are thinking, doesn't matter. It is the court. It must be appearing to the court that the confession is being caused by inducement, threat or promise. So friends, for this, what is confession? What do you mean by confession? Confession is something when you accept something, admit something. Now you will say, this is what admission was. Admission was also the same thing when you were admitting something, right? But what is the essential difference between admissions and confession is that admission may not be in regard to your own liability. Very important, very, very important, because we saw the sections where admissions were being made by other parties also on the basis of which a third party was being prosecuted, right? But as far as confession is concerned, there are basic rules regarding confession. First rule regarding confession is that it has to be made by the person who is accused. Second, it must relate to his liability. The statement must be directly hinging upon his liability in a particular case. So these two requirements make confession different from admissions. So if a particular statement comes before the court of law, which is in the nature of confession and which is appearing to the court to be caused by inducement, threat or promise, this is the second requirement that we are talking about. Now we should try to understand what is meant by this inducement, threat or promise and how they are different from each other. So as far as this term inducement is concerned, inducement means like a give and take exercise. Give and take exercise, like a particular person is inducing you to do something. So what is the driver that is driving you is that you want something from that person, right? That other person is offering you something which is beneficial for you. And in return of that, you are doing something. And in this case, you are making confession. So if a particular person is inducing you, is showing you something which is beneficial for you, and in response to that, you are doing that, that is called inducement. Okay, this is a positive calling by one person to the other to do something. Now come to what is threat. Threat is the anti side of inducement. In threat, you are not positively asking that person. You are not attracting that person. In threat, you are making it fearful, making the person fearful. Okay, you are threatening him of his life or family. Okay, or there can be innumerable kind of threats. But this is negative aspect. In here, two parties are anti of each other. One is saying that I am going to hurt you. This is what threat is. This is how threat is different from inducement. Now the question comes, what is promise? And how promise is different from inducement? So friends, as far as promise is concerned, in promise, there is, though it is also a positive aspect, not negative aspect as threat was. But in promise, there are two parties which are more or less of equal standing, right? In inducement, there is an initiation from one side, the person who is inducing, and the other person is responding to that. But in promise, there are two parties, both have something to give to each other, and they are coming into relation with each other for that purpose, right? That is called promise. So there is a difference of inducement and promise. In inducement comes from one party to other. In promise, both the parties come together. Okay. So if a particular confession is being caused by inducement, that one a particular person has promised something to this accused person, and because of this, he is making such a statement which is amounting to confession. This is the first. If a particular confession is caused by threat, so if a particular person is threatening this person, accused person, that if you did not make this confession, I will kill you or your family or I will destroy your property, that will also be not admissible. And finally, if a confession is a result of a promise that if you make this confession in a court of law, I will do this for you. Okay, a promise kind of thing. Okay, so in all the, if any of these three things are the reason for confession and this is appearing to the court of law, this is the second requirement, right? So the first requirement that was that it has to be criminal proceeding. The second requirement that it must be appearing to the court that the confession is being caused by inducement, threat or promise that we just understood. The third important thing, very important aspect is that all these inducement, threat or promise that we were talking about, they must be in reference to the charge against the accused person. They must be in reference to the case which is going on against that person, right? So it can't be an independent inducement. The inducement has to be in relation to that case itself. Like if you make this particular confession, I will discharge all the other accused from the case. For example, okay, if their two brothers are being prosecuted for the offense of murder, then this person, okay, this the other party, the prosecution side, induces this person A, okay, if you make a confession right now, we will let go the person B, your brother. So this is what? This is an inducement, right? And this is in relation to the case also. So this is what is barred by section 24. Same goes with threat, same goes with promise. So it is very important that this inducement, threat or promise should have reference to the case itself, to the charge against the accused person, right? So we have covered three requirements so far. Now come to fourth requirement. Very, very important that this inducement, threat or promise must be coming from such a person who is in authority. Such a person who is in authority over the accused person. Now, who will be such persons? Who will be such persons? These persons may be police authorities, because he is arrested right now, he is in custody right now, so they are in authority. Other public officers who are dealing with that person, right? Now, other, and this term authority, a person in authority, may also involve persons like the family members of accused person, right? If they are inducing, if a family member, for example, if father of the accused person is inducing him that you make a confession right now and allow your brother to be left free. So he has that influence over him, right? He is in that relationship with him. So and on the basis of that, and this term, as far as a person in authority is concerned, it is quite broad. What is the test to determine whether a particular person was in authority or not is to see what was the level of influence that person was having over this accused person. It may be either because of the present situation of the accused person, because he is being prosecuted in a particular case, or it may be generally. Okay, so as far as the father relation was concerned, it is a general person. Okay, general relation that is making it authoritative. But as far as the police officers and other public officials were concerned, that was because of his situation that he is being prosecuted in a particular case, right? So fourth requirement was that all these inducement, threat or promise must be coming from a person who is in authority. Very, very important. And fifth requirement is that this inducement, threat or promise must be sufficient in the opinion of the court to give the accused person grounds which would appear to him reasonable for supposing that by making it he would gain any advantage or avoid any evil. So as far as this fifth requirement is concerned, it is simply saying that such inducement, threat or promise that has been given to the accused person, it must be sufficient. It must be sufficient for what? That the accused person must be satisfied. He must have accepted that if I did something, if I made a confession in response to inducement, threat or promise, something good will happen to me because of the inducement or promise, or something bad will happen to me because of the threat if I did not make it, right? So it must be sufficient so as to influence the accused person. So a threat itself or inducement itself or promise itself is not sufficient. It has to be sufficient also. So the fifth requirement of section 24 talks about sufficiency of that inducement, threat or promise. But who will decide the sufficiency? It is again the court of law. Okay, it must be sufficient in the eyes of court of law, right? So if all these five requirements are satisfied in any particular case, any criminal case, then the confession that has been made by the accused person will not be admitted, will be irrelevant in that case, right? So again, a quick recap. What are the requirements of section 24? What does section 24 provides for? First, there has to be a criminal proceedings. It has to be criminal proceedings. Okay? It must be appearing. This is very important. It must be appearing to the court of law that the confession is made, has been caused by inducement, threat or promise. Appearing to the court of law that the confession has been caused by inducement, threat or promise. So it is not the reality whether it was caused by inducement, threat or promise. We are not going to that question. We are only seeing whether it is appearing to the court of law or not. Okay, so it is for the court. And finally, that this third requirement, this inducement, threat or promise must have relation to the present case, must be related to the charge against the accused person. Very important requirement. And fourth requirement is that this inducement, threat or promise must be coming from a person in authority. And I have already told you this is a very broad concept of person in authority. It may include a lot of person. Okay, so it is for the court to decide whether the person who actually gave the inducement, threat or promise was a person in authority or not. So the fourth requirement. And finally, the fifth requirement is that the inducement, threat or promise must be sufficient so as to influence the accused person. And sufficiency has to be judged by the eyes of the court of law. So five requirements. Okay, so as far as the role of the court is concerned, becomes important as far as the second requirement or fifth requirement was concerned. It must be appearing to the court of law that it is caused by inducement, threat or promise, second requirement, and it must be sufficient in the eyes of the law. Okay, so five requirements. So friends, this was our section 24 of Indian Evidence Act. I hope you understood what I was trying to say, what I was trying to explain. So friends, if you have any questions regarding that, if there is something you did not understand about it, try to rewatch the video first. If even after that you did not understand it, there is a Telegram group. I have created a Telegram group. The invitation link to the Telegram group is pasted in the description box of this video. So you can click on that, be a part of the Telegram group and ask your question. I will try to respond to them as early as possible. And until then, friends, be happy, be safe. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel. I'll see you very soon. Bye-bye.